Good morning. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the 54th annual Herbert H. Lehman Memorial Lecture. Yes, yes. Clap it up. Clap it up. At this time, I want to welcome to the stage the fourth president of Lehman College, Dr. Fernando Delgado.
Welcome, everybody. We're running a little bit behind schedule, but I'm a Mexican from California, so we're just right on time, Chicano time. And speaking of from being from California, I appreciate the music, although when I walked in here in Miley Cyrus, I sort of, whoa, am I back in Minnesota, but we moved on. But as I said, I'm a California kid, so I get to be your MC briefly. I get to introduce our keynoter, and he'll introduce what follows. So my job is easy as the president, and to invoke the lyrics of somebody who's near and dear to my heart as a young person, I get to be laid back, sipping my water. What comes in the juice is for after work. So welcome to the 54th Lehman Lecture. The Lehman Lecture is named after the person that we're all named after at this institution, Herbert H. Lehman, a renowned, famous, and committed elected official who was part of the New York landscape for decades and whose profound commitment was to public service, civic engagement, and community empowerment. And we live that at Lehman. I know we live that at Lehman, even though I've only been here 2.5 years, because as I've made my rounds around the Bronx, I've constantly encountered students who want to make a difference, alums who are making a difference, and other alums who may still be coming back for master's programs, who themselves are elected officials, or whose family members work for elected officials, or they may be staffers for elected officials, all in that spirit of public service and civic engagement. And it's great pride that I get to serve as the president of an institution with that value system, that purpose, and that connection to our community. I think that's part of what makes Lehman special, and that's why it's special for Lehman to be a part of the Bronx. Today I get to introduce somebody, Rubén Díaz Jr., who's probably no better indicator of being a part of that fabric. As a civil servant, as a community member, as a student and alum of Lehman College. Rubén came to make a difference, has made a difference, continues to make a difference. 12 years as the Bronx Borough President, 12 years before that as a state elected official, now Senior Vice President for Strategic Initiatives at Montefiore Hospital, and more importantly to us, a dear friend and member of the Herbert H. Lehman Foundation. This is a gentleman who wants to give, has given, and continues to give. And I think most importantly for today, he wants to inspire, particularly the young people out here, to think about what your path is, where you've come from, where you're going, and the many ways in which you can make a positive difference while you pursue your professional and personal dreams. He cares deeply about this institution. He cares even more deeply about the Bronx and its 1.8 million people. And 2 years ago, he turned to me and he said, hey, we gotta pump up the Lehman Lecture and try something exciting and invigorating. And I said, what? I'm 50-some years old. Takes a lot of coffee just to get me out the front door. And he said, I have an idea. And that idea evolved. And I said, let's try it. Because at the end of the day, as an educator, well, I want to educate and entertain everybody that comes here. Ultimately, the goal of the lecture is to target the young people, the students, who are or will be students at Lehman College. Because when you graduate, we want you, we need you to make a difference in this city, and most assuredly, in this borough and in this neighborhood. So, without further ado, let me introduce the youngest looking 30-year-old man who's had a 24-year sojourn through elected life, Rubén Díaz Jr.
Thinking of a master plan. This ain't nothing but sweat inside my hands. So I dig into my pocket, all my money spent. So I dig deep up, still coming up with lint. So I start my mission, leave my residence.
How y'all feeling this morning or this afternoon? Come on, make some noise. It's Lehman in the house. It's the Bronx in the house. To President Delgado and to all of my fellow board members at the Lehman College Foundation, it is a pleasure to be with you here this afternoon, this morning here at our beautiful campus on this illustrious traditional event, the Herbert H. Lehman Lecture Series. As the President Delgado said earlier, when you look at Herbert H. Lehman, and by the way, I was a student at Herbert H. Lehman High School as well, here in the Bronx. And there we go. How many times you go to a school is named after someone and you really don't know who that person was or what that person did to merit that institution being named after them? And when you look at Herbert H. Lehman, who was a governor of the state of New York, who was a U.S. senator representing the state of New York, who did wonderful for himself and his family with Lehman Brothers. But there was always a core belief in Herbert H. Lehman to, no matter where you are in life, no matter what your resources are, to give back. He had this passion for social justice. He had this passion and this commitment to make sure that you afford your fellow citizens more of an opportunity. See, I believe that in the Bronx, in the boogie down Bronx, I believe that in the city of New York, and in so many other communities throughout the United States, that talent is abundant. The question is, are you offered the opportunities in order to make sure that you can seek your passion, that you can maximize on your talents? And quite often, unfortunately, in many communities of color, in many communities that are challenged financially, we don't see those opportunities, but we certainly see a lot of talent. And when I was invited to speak at this lecture series, I felt the weight, felt the responsibility of this assignment. When I was asked to come and speak before you, and I've been to lecture series in the past, I understood that perhaps it was maybe because I'm a poor Puerto Rican kid from the Bronx, from Puerto Rican parents who started a family at a young age, who started politics at a very young age. I am a CUNY twofer. I went to LaGuardia Community College, received my associate's degree, and then came here to Lehman College, right here in the heart of the Bronx. All through it all, I was a young husband, a young father, a young elected official. Through it all, I was trying to pass and vote on legislation to make and create opportunities for not only my fellow Bronxites at the time, but for future young adults such as yourself. As the 13th borough president, I was able to spearhead over 5,000 units of housing. The first day that I took office, the unemployment rate in the Bronx was 14%. The February before COVID struck us, we were just under 5%. 117,000 more Bronxites were working than the first day that I took office. It was the highest. It was the highest workforce participation in the entire history of our borough. We were able to make sure that we had private sector come in and not just do business in the Bronx, but do business with the Bronx. I was able to navigate government and to get some of my partners at every level of government to do the Bruckner-Sheridan interchange, to bring in 4 Metro North stations to the Bronx, to bring in more development, but also to do something that was near and dear to my heart, is to bring the first ever hip-hop museum right here in the Boogie Down Bronx. I don't want to stand up here and lecture for 45 minutes. This is the negotiations that I had with President Delgado. I wanted to do something a little different. I also wanted to pay respect and homage to Herbert H. Lehman and everything that he stood for. And so while we are breaking from format today, we will not break from the tradition of what this lecture series is supposed to be. This is supposed to be about civic mindedness. This lecture series is supposed to be about how is it that no matter where you are, just like Herbert H. Lehman, no matter what opportunities, no matter what your talents are, no matter where life takes you, how do you come and give back to the community that you're from? This is not about a concert. If you thought there was gonna be one, we could take that up afterwards. And so what I wanted to do is to bring someone from the hip hop community who's also was also a poor kid from the Bronx, who has mastered his craft, who has traveled the entire planet, who has rubbed elbows with everyone that you could ever imagine, but never, ever, ever once did he forget where he come from. And so, he's Grammy nominated, he's an author, businessman, a husband, a father, an entrepreneur. And when you look at Fat Joe, so much of what he embodies is also what Herbert H. Lehman embodied. Two different individuals, different times, same mission, same vision, same heart. Ladies and gentlemen, please help me welcome our guest today, my brother, Fat Joe.
Nothing can stop me. I'm all the way up. All the way up. All the way up. All the way up. I'm all the way up. I'm all the way up. Nothing can stop me. I'm all the way up.
Shorty, what you want? Shorty, what you need?
What you need?
My niggas run game. We ain't never leave.
Joe, how you doing, Joe? Are we on? Are we mic'd? Microphone check. 1, 2. What is this?
1, 2. Y'all can hear me?
Can we hear you?
1, 2.
Are we good? Okay. Yeah. So how you doing, Joe?
Yo, what's up? Lehman, what's good, y'all?
Let's make some noise for Fat Joe. So Joe, I was telling everyone here that, you know, this is the Herbert H. Lehman lecture series. And what I didn't want is to stand up here and speak for 45 minutes. I wanted to make sure that we also, however, stuck to the body and the tradition and the spirit of what this lecture series, and that's being civic-mindedness. I remember as a very young boy in my family, some of the very first times that I could remember giving back was when my dad was the head of senior citizen programs. My father, Reverend Díaz, had senior citizen programs, senior citizen services, and I remember my sister who's around there, Damaris, my brother and I, my parents used to take us, and so that we could feed the seniors at the senior citizen center. I was 5, 6, 7 years old. And that was the beginning for me to give back to the community. Joe, we know everything that you've done in music. Everybody admires when they see you, you know, out there on a stage and being a fixture and being now an extremely influential entertainer. What I want people to know is the Joe that I know. What I want people to understand is the body of work, the heart, the spirit of Fat Joe, Joseph Cartagena. Mm. And so the beginnings for me, I just explained. I told them you're not gonna rap and this is not a concert. What I want them to know is, let's start at the beginning, like,
I could do this for you, right? Uh-huh. So, to the young people in here, I know you find it hard to believe because ever since you was born, Fat Joe was a rap star. But to the older people, they probably could relate. I don't know if people really truly understand what I mean when I say we were poor. We were really dirt poor. We were really on welfare. We were really in the projects. My mom's had 4 kids, had to work 3 jobs at the same time. And even though we were very poor, we always had love. And so, believe it or not, I don't know what the price of an Uber is, but back in the days, we would travel from my mother's job to my house in Forest Projects to our apartment, and the cab would be $2. My mother would pull out $5 and give him a $3 tip. Yet this woman was struggling. She was poor with four kids living in the projects. She was always giving. As me being a, I'm shooting all the way from there, saying me being a successful rapper, I was already rich at this point, and my mother and father refused to move out the projects. They just would not move out the projects. So New Year's Eve, Christmas, whatever, you wanna find Fat Joe? He's in apartment 5E. There was nothing I could do to get them to move out of this environment, right? And I'm number one in the world, right? And now I'm pulling up in a Rolls Royce to the projects, and they like, they just didn't wanna leave. They didn't get it. And so, but every time I pulled up to the projects, my mother's door was wide open, and I'm not trying to be disrespectful, but there were crackheads in our kitchen fixing sandwiches for themselves. In my mother's house, Fat Joe the Rapper's house, fixing sandwiches. Now, I get up in there, I'm like, yo, y'all better get the, I'm telling you now, boy. Like, I'm not playing with you. And then, you know, my mom's would be like, that's little Junior, that's little Ted. And so we come from a family of giving even when we don't got. And so that's why you see where my heart is at when it comes to philanthropy, to giving back to our community. It's crazy because I got a friend, she's a billionaire. She started with nothing, and I went to, she had like, I guess one of these, right? yeah, she had one of these discussions, so I just pulled up on her because I was in LA, and she asked me for no reason. She said, Joe, what's your why? And immediately my why was my family, my community. I knew that like off the tip of my tongue, I knew it was my family and my community. That's my why. That's why I work hard. That's why I do what I do, is for my family and my community. Is that they're equal to me.
Thank you. Thank you for that. So for those of you who don't know, this is a brotherhood that goes back almost 30 years. Joe and I met outside of Forest Project.
You want me to say something?
So, tell them how we met.
I'm already Fat Joe the Rapper, right? But I'm visiting my mother and father in Forest Projects. And I might have been driving too fast. I almost ran over Rubén Díaz. Real talk. I almost hit Rubén Díaz. So he backed up. He said, he looks in and he says, yo, Fat Joe the Rapper, what's up, man? And I'm like, who are you? Because I don't see guys in a suit in Forest Projects at 9 o'clock at night. He was like, yo, I was just talking to some citizens. I'm Councilman Rubén Díaz. I was like, oh, I know who you is. I know who you are. I've been watching you, you know, Bronx Net, you know? And so we became friends ever since. And it's so weird because, you know, his father is a senator, right? Mm-hmm. He wears this cowboy hat. He's really in church. Now, I mean, really in church. His father's like, don't play. He's about that church. I'm probably the only exception he ever made to the church. You know, they used to have me as Santa Claus on Christmas. Anything he wanted to do, the man would walk in and be like, we got Fat Joe the Rapper. And I would come out of door number one and do whatever he told me. But, you know, we're brothers. I love Rubén in a different way. And said, I just told his sister that I personally told Rubén if he was, I know he's not, but when I thought he was going for mayor, I was like, Rubén, I'm gonna get locked up on TV, putting posters up. What? Rubén Díaz of mayor. I was gonna go to jail. They was gonna have to drag me in the car. Rubén! It's my guy.
I wanna get into some specifics so that whoever is here and whoever is gonna see this later on, this is not hyperbole in when I say that Joe has given back to the community. There are clear examples of this. I remember when we asked Joe to come and be with us at a Christmas parade in the sandwich section of the Bronx, and Joe gave out tickets. Joe, there was one time where, no, not one time. I want to be very clear here. every single time, not most, not the majority of the time, every single time that we've done what I'm about to tell y'all we did, I never had to call him. It was him calling me about what he wanted to do for the community. And so remember now, I want you to follow along here. I'm a young assembly member. He's a world-renowned artist, and he's anywhere on the planet, and I get calls. Take us through one of the calls that you gave me. Said, Rubén, I want to get computers and do a library over at one of the schools that you attended. What was the origins of that?
Man, I don't know, man. Now that you're explaining it to me like that, it feels like almost like survivor's guilt. You know what I mean? Nah, I'm keeping it real. Like, it feels like, man, these people fed me. They gave me pork chops. They protected me when the cops came. They snuck me in the back of the building. They dissed everything, man. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I feel like I'm obligated to help my community. It's like, it's not even, all right, so you see what's going on with Haiti, mm-hmm. right? And so I feel like nobody's talking about Haiti, nobody's trying to help Haiti, nobody's at this. So other day I'm on my IG and I'm like, yo, we gotta help Haiti, right? And so, well, after I do that, right? So we're looking into like, how can we help Haiti? Because they're in war, we don't know who's corrupt, we don't know who's gonna take the money, who's gonna this. So I'm gonna do what I say I do, I always do, right? But we just gotta vet this really, really, this is a tricky one right here, right? I stepped in. But that night I had dinner with my wife and we start talking and I look at my wife in the eyes, by the way, I've been with her for 30 years and I said, I don't care. She's looking at me, I said, I don't care. I have to help Haiti, I don't care. I don't care, it's what it is, that's what has to happen. That's what's gonna happen, and we're gonna help Haiti. And she looked at me like she knows, you know, you got a tough one here. I'm like, all right, you'll see. We're gonna help Haiti, you know?
So that's the, and we appreciate that. What I want is for folks, because everyone always says give back, give back. And so what I want us to stick to a little bit here are just a thought process on specific give backs, right? So, mm-hmm. Because like what triggers you saying I wanna do computers and the library.
We had a real good one with the sneakers.
I'm gonna get to that.
Are we not there yet?
We're not there yet. That's what I'm saying. We had so many. So
computers in the school?
In the school. That was your school. Right. Let's go step by step.
I don't want to be disrespectful. I know we in the college. There's only one school I ever attended that I like. It's called CS146. Okay. And I was a little kid and I was there and my teachers were so beautiful to me. So I feel like a bond with that school more than anywhere, right? It's also across the street from the projects I grew up at. So I went up in there one day myself, Fat Joe, snuck up in there, and I realized there wasn't one computer in the school. Now, our kids can't compete with the future. Our kids can't stay up if they don't have the proper tools to stay up. So I walked up in there and I said, you have a computer? They was like, nah, we ain't got no computers, right? And so I stepped to Ruben. I said, yo, Ruben, we gotta make a computer library for the kids, buy a bunch of computers, make sure they got computers here because these kids gotta be able to compete. Now I could tell you a bunch, all right, yeah, see, I'm gonna stay to the topic.
Stay to the topic, yeah. Yeah, clap it up for that, go computers in the school. No one gives out more food and turkeys than Fat Joe. Where does that come from?
Everybody gotta eat. I remember, right? Mm-hmm. I remember one Thanksgiving watching my mother, I wouldn't say beg, but the word beg comes to it. She wasn't getting paid till like Saturday and Thanksgiving was on Wednesday. And I seen her had to humble herself because we're very proud. So even though we were poor, I let you know. My mom, she cursed me out every time I say I was broke, I was this. She be like, bro, y'all the fattest kids on the block. Y'all ate everything. She says, stop that. I be like, Ma, I know it bothers you, but I gotta tell people, I gotta say transparency. I gotta tell you the truth. So one time my mother, and trust me, this is a proud woman, she had to ask my grandfather for money so she could buy Thanksgiving. And so that resonated with me for life, where I know it's hard out here and people don't have it. And imagine you don't have Thanksgiving. Imagine that. You sitting in the house and you don't have a turkey. You don't got no food. You ain't got nothing. How are you supposed to look like, you know, a role model or something to your kids, right? So we go above and beyond. We bring 3 18-wheelers every year. I mean, it's like they're at Whole Foods. So you get your turkey, you get your produce, you get your rice, you get your pasta, you get your soups, you get the, they're shopping. Like they're out there literally shopping, right? Right? And me, like I said, my why is my community and for some reason, you know, I don't use drugs. If that's hard to believe, I don't use drugs at all. That gets me high. When I see people just getting their food and I stand out there, that's the stuff that really touches me. That's the stuff where that night I go to sleep real happy. Like I'm like, wow, you see all these families we fed? You see how many people ate, how many people put Thanksgiving on the table? That's the stuff that's the accolades or the legacy that Fat Joe wants to leave behind one day. So when they tally it up, they be like, man, this guy, man, he was out here really looking out for the people. He was giving back, whatever the case may be. That's what that's one of the top things I want to be known for.
Let's get it. Yeah. Again, thought process behind the sneaker giveaway.
You know, this guy's really smart, right? So let me tell you something. He was the Bronx Borough president for 12 years. And every time I talk to this guy, he's one of my best friends, I learn something new. So this time we learned the word or the phrase, empirical data. He taught me empirical data. And I'm saying, by the way, I wasn't like a college grad or nothing like that, right? I'm pretty intelligent, but I pick up on these empirical data, right? So I'm always like, yo, what's the empirical data? Yo, what's the empirical data, right? So we did the empirical data run. So one day I'm sitting there, I say to myself, you know, because things are very bad out here, crime, poverty, things is really bad out here in the streets. And let me tell you something, if you are numb to it, right? So just yesterday, I came to New York. I live in Miami. I live in Jersey too. So I came to my house. I got my whole team together, right? And everybody's secure. I'm not bragging. I'm making more money than I ever made in my life, thank God, right? And I'm telling my team, I'm like, yo, you get paid great money. You get great. I sit them all down. I said, but you know, people are hurting out there bad. And so you got to be aware of your environment. You gotta know what's going on out there. And so I'm telling them like, yo, we so blessed, but we gotta be very careful because everybody's hurting out here, right? But the point is, one day I couldn't sleep and I was thinking to myself, what would a Fat Joe, because I was very intelligent. Like I don't know if y'all remember, they used to have this thing called IGC, Intellectual Gifted Child.
I was one of them.
So I was always in IGC. They did an essay of, the smartest kid in the Bronx gets to be the borough president. I met Stanley Simon. I won the award, right? I would skip 2 grades, right? Just because I went towards the street didn't mean I wasn't intelligent. I always say if I grew up in a better environment, I probably would have been a doctor or a lawyer. It's just the truth, right? And so I said, what would make a Fat Joey, little kid, class clown, bully, motivate him to change his behavior, change his grades, change everything. So I said, Rubén, I got an idea. He said, what? I said, everybody wants sneakers. Everybody wants Jordans. Everybody wants this. I'm talking about the real Jordans, like, you know, that, right? And so a guy like me who didn't have nothing coming up, if somebody came to my school like Fat Joe in the Bronx and said, hey, if you do better in reading, if you do better in behavior, if your attendance is great, we're gonna give you a free pair for the whole class. We're gonna, actually it was like what, 4 8 classes?
Yeah, so just a little background.
Because you
here.
Know I'm fried.
No. A little background here. We went to 4 different schools at the beginning of the school year, and we filled up the auditorium with all of the students. They were all excited to see Joe. Joe then says, how many people here want a free pair of sneakers? Any sneaker you want, though. Everybody goes crazy. He says, I want to do that, but for the winning class, and this is the three criteria. It was attendance, grades, overall behavior. Not for any single student, because we know that there are students who would have ran away with that easily.
Yeah.
It was a class effort. So we, you know, and they didn't take it seriously at first until then we would go back a month later, ask everybody in those school for their sneaker size, and then we wind up getting winners, right?
The best attendance, the class clown, the bully was now the most loving guy in the world. The bullies were crying.
Yes.
Am I lying?
No.
Bully of the whole school was crying. I used to pick on everybody. I love my students. It was like, it was unbelievable.
It was unbelievable.
What happened up in there? It was unbelievable.
So before I get to the next one, the empirical data showed us that when we did that, and we got criticized, there were so many people who were telling us and sending us through social media, why don't you do more computers? Why don't you do this? Why don't you do that? Joe was clairvoyant enough to know that the kids on this wanted what they wanted, which is in this case, sneakers. And if you look at from September through December, in the whole school, not just the class that won, attendance went up in all four schools. Behavior got better in all four schools. Grades went up in all four schools. We had the principals and the teachers give us that data. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't really sustainable because he put out tens of thousands of dollars. Like, these kids wanted the Jordan sneakers.
The real ones. Not the jump man.
So, unfortunately, I have to say this, it worked. You know why it worked? Because when you look at the data after that, everything then dropped again.
Mm.
You know, the attendance dropped. Behavior got, you know, bad again. And so the test scores, the kids were motivated, and he is not lying. When we went to one of the schools, when we asked, you know, and I try to be really diplomatic about it, and I said, who is like the clown? But I really meant like, who's the really badass of the class? He gets up and he told us that he thought we were full of BS at first, but when he started to see that this was real, the class was helping him out, he was practically bullying kids to come to school because he wanted his sneakers. Yeah. And there he goes with his sneakers and he thanked the whole class, he thanked the teachers, and he was all boiling up in tears, the toughest kid in the class. And that was Joe's initiative, the sneaker giveaway. Give him up for him. On September 20th, the native island of my parents, Puerto Rico, got hit with one of the worst storms and hurricanes in history, Hurricane Maria. And it was devastating for us to see what was happening on the island, the fact that we could not get in contact with loved ones. There was nothing that they can do to call us. They had absolutely no electricity on the whole island. There was no type of service. And going back to my dad a little bit, my father is the president of what's called the New York Hispanic Clergy Organization. And every time there's a calamity or a disaster, the organization, they end up doing something in the Bronx where they collect meals or water and clothing and everything. But my father had called me and he said, look, I want to do this. I want you to help me with the permits so that we could do it at Aldous Avenue. Except that we didn't have the money to ship the containers, the large containers, over to Puerto Rico. And we were wrapping our heads around it. My father says, it was like 11 o'clock at night. And my father says, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to pray on this. Next morning, I get a call.
Very important.
Rubén, if I don't do something for Puerto Rico, my wife is gonna kill me. And I was like, oh my goodness. Joe, this is what my father and I were having a conversation yesterday. He says, order all the containers that you want, you know, and so on and so forth. But when we talk about hip hop with a heart, something else happened. Now he has friends, and I want him to talk about this, who said, you know what, I have airplanes. And so, Joe, take it from there when your friends offered the airplane. Now we knew we had to fill up
the airplane. First of all, let me tell y'all this, man. I'm getting old, and I'm at the point where I believe God drives the car. And so I believe if we're going through a tough time, he's going to push us through. If people trying to cancel you or talk about you, he's going to get us through. At the end of the day, he says, if you have faith and you believe in me, you're going to beat everything. Once you die, you're dead. You're gone, right? And so I totally believe that, and I believe that his father was in the jam, and God went and said, boom, 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 yo, Joe, let's go, right? Now, it was really scary, Puerto Rico. It was really scary because not only was I worried about the people, so I'm really talking to you students. You see, your age right now, you never truly leave that. So just because my body is older and I'm older, I'm still the little kid from the projects, right? And so when there's a task so big that you see a country in trouble, like, who are you, Joe, to help these people? Like, how could you do this? You're just a rapper from the projects. So you sit there overwhelmed. And my wife, she looked at me, and she ain't Puerto Rican, she Colombian. She looked at me, she said, bro, like, that's your people. Like, I'm going to be honest with you, and I let's not turn this political, but when Donald Trump threw them tissues at the Puerto Ricans, my wife was like, oh, no. She was like, all that stuff you be talking, like, it's time. Like, you got to show up. I said, yo, mom, I'm from the projects. Like, what do you want me to do? It was so overwhelming, right? And so I called Rubén. Rubén was like, yo, what he's going to do? And then Rubén starts calling me. So I put out, like, an Instagram, and I say, yo, we collecting for Puerto Rico. Bro, every strip club, every... No, the Muslims pulled up in an 18-wheeler full, and then the Hasidic Jews pulled up right behind them with an 18-wheeler full of, you couldn't make this up, what was going on out here. They came through, like the strippers was to everybody, right? And so it was one of the most beautiful, touching moments, in, I think, in New York history, but as well as, you know, I hold all my friends accountable, even though they're not accountable. So when Fat Joe calls, it's almost like, you know, you got to do what you got to do, right? And so I call Dubai. My people out there who act like they're our friends, yo, what's up? My people messed up. Sending the wire, Joe. Y'all, I called Jay-Z. Let me tell you something. Anything Fat Joe ever did, Jay-Z's involved. He just don't want credit for it. He don't take credit for it. But he gives up so fast. He's always in. Like, when I tell you I'm about to help Haiti, I'm definitely tapping Jay-Z for that Haiti. Right? And so I had a bunch of friends, too many to name, that kept just sending money, help. And then the people... Because the airplanes was 255,000 an airplane. I had an argument with them, right? Because I believe, you know.
Say that again, Joe. Say that again, the airplane.
Every single airplane was $255,000. And I spoke to the owner in front of Ruben, and he was like, I don't care. This is business for me. You have 255. I'm like, yo, but what about the people? He was like, yo, I'm helping the people. My plane is going over there. I said, wow. Swear to God, it happened just like that. And they had TV cameras while I was with the guy smiling, and he was telling me this. I was like, wow. Like, these people are, listen, there's evil and there's good. There's just no way around it. And so not only did we have to send the food, we had to pay for these planes. So I had all my friends that, you know, that got money and all that. Not just rappers, just people. I know a lot of people. And I was just like, yo, we need you. And everybody chipped in, and we got the planes over there. We got generators over there. I mean, we paid for so much stuff, Ruben. Yeah, we was Bronx, going crazy.
Just in the Bronx alone, the little poor Bronx, one of the, and I have some of my old Borough president crew here with me, Prisca, nah. Carmel,
don't get us thrown out.
The Bronx did over 300,000 pounds. Of water, clothing. On Aldous Avenue, we shut down that. We were supposed to stop collecting with the ministers. We had three containers initially. we had to stop. We wanted to stop collecting maybe 12 o'clock, 1 o'clock in the afternoon. We were there all the way 24 hours. We had to have the governor bring in the National Guard to protect the stuff that we couldn't store, that it was still out in the street until we were able to get more containers. Great. And those were the stuff that we were able to send over there, thanks to Joe, Jay-Z, because hip hop has a heart. and it was one of the most proudest moments of my borough presidency. Speaking of hip hop has a heart, there was a big tragedy on January 9th, 2022, where there was a fire. Mm. And we lost so many lives in the Bronx. Mm. Joe, you did something there with hip hop.
Tell them
what you did with it.
I'm to the point now where, you know, I got a mentor. He passed away. His name is J.R. Ridinger. And he was a billionaire. He made it from nothing. He taught me a lot. You know, I got in trouble with the law. And he tried to give me a $1 million check because they took all my money. They took all my money, millions of dollars. It's crazy because even at my court case, the prosecutor was telling the judge, he was trying to put me in jail. This guy gives back. He gives back, this guy. Like, who he thinks he is. He didn't pay his taxes, but he gives food. He gives, like, it was crazy in there. Like, this guy was mad. I give back, right? And if he's watching, I'm still giving back. Like, I'm still giving back. And so this was really an argument in the courtroom, right? No, this is amazing to me, right? I got in trouble for giving back. Ain't that something, right? And so that's the first time I said that, by the way. And so I have a friend, he's a billionaire. We was friends for years. Him and his wife were crying, chasing me around their apartment with a $1 million check. Please, please, brother, please. I was like, I can't take that. So he said, I'm gonna teach you how to do business so you could never go broke again in your life. So I was with him 5 years in a row, every single day I'm with him, just like a sponge, absorbing business, just chilling with a billionaire, a genius. Like, you know, and I'm just listening, and I'm just like, oh wow, you know, this is how I'm gonna use it in my business when I do it. And what was the question
explain?
So the fire, right? And so JR would say, when you get something started, I don't want to curse guys, but he would say, oh, now you stepped in some shit. Because once you start something, you got to see it through. You know, a lot of people talk something, a lot of people say they're going to do something, and then they give up and they quit. That's most people, 99% of the people. So now once you stepped on shit, you got to see this through, right? And so I'm taking on a position where I'm sitting here in front of everybody in the Bronx saying I like to help. Of course, when the Muslim brothers and sisters died in the fire, who the first person you think they called? The helper. He's like, Joe, we need you. I said, no problem, I got this. Don't worry about it. I'm gonna get to business. We're gonna do what we gotta do. It's almost become almost like, it's almost become like, I gotta do it. Like, they come like, yo, Joe, what's up? Yeah, you gotta do it. Like, Joe, you gotta do it. It's a problem over here. Like, you know, and so we raised $2 million that we gave to the people. And so, and that was pretty amazing because people donated there that I didn't even know who they was, right? So they donated until Joe, Jack donated. And I'm like, who the hell's Jack, right? No, I mean $500,000, big money, Jack. Well, this is the guy who invented Twitter. He owns Twitter, Joe. He sent the money. I said, God damn, they think about the Bronx on Twitter, huh? And so it was amazing people. And so what I see is that a lot of people like to give back. It just has to be, you know, vetted right, where it's uncorrupt, because you got to see it through. With Puerto Rico, we went over there and made sure we saw the food given to the people. Me and him flew over there and was looking at, like, okay, now Haiti might be trickier, right? Because they shooting the place. So I don't know if Fat Joe that tough, but it's like, you know, but, you know, we gotta, you know, in life, I believe, man, we was talking about different ideologies last night at dinner. Mm-hmm. And in life, I believe in capitalism. So I want you all to be as rich as you want to be. I want you to be as rich as you want to be, right? So I believe in you living a good life. But I also believe, when is enough enough? I also believe, why not help your people, the less fortunate? Why not give them inspiration? Why not be there for your people? You know, I don't know if you're going to talk about this, but you know, most guys who, you are?
Go ahead.
Okay, so most guys when and girls get famous, and they dream, let me get out this hood, let me get out this project, let me get out the Bronx. And they literally get out the Bronx and we never see them again in life, in history, right? And so I don't believe in that. I believe in building businesses back in my community. I believe in showing everybody that you don't have to be famous. If you want to be a business person, open back up in your community.
Joe, let me say this. Let me be a little generous to those folks, right? Let's just say, because we always criticize people who make it and don't give back. Is it perhaps that, I mean, and we touched on so many different real concrete scenarios where you and I collaborated. You would call, you pay for everything, mm-hmm. we coordinate and execute, I get mm-hmm. some of the credit as well. but there was this brotherhood of camaraderie. Is it that maybe folks who have the resources don't necessarily have that relationship where they can coordinate with someone?
I'm definitely gonna say that, but I also have rich friends that don't wanna give back, that they look at me like I'm crazy. Okay. And so I have a new group of friends. I think they the CIA, now they know I know. No, I'm real talk, like, right? So I live in Miami. Fat Joe New York is very different than Fat Joe Miami. Fat Joe Miami would be wearing a sky blue silk shirt with white pants giving this speech, right? So.
It's his favorite color, I know that.
And so, so Miami Fat Joe and New York Fat Joe is totally different, right? Mm-hmm. So Miami Fat Joe, he got a silk shirt on, he's smelling good, he's walking through. I meet all type of rich people out there, right? So I met this old man, I don't want to say his name, but when I seen him, I knew he was special for some reason. He just had this linen jacket on. And I'm not looking rich, just, he just walked. I don't care if he was in Germany, you would look at him and be like, oh no, this guy's somebody. Like, he just was somebody, the jacket over the thing. And he looked at me, he stopped me and said, you're somebody. I said, I was thinking the same thing about you. He was like, nah, you somebody. So we became cool. So now we have lunch together and he brings all his billionaire friends and we talk about, we call it the conversation. So a lot of them are Republicans, a lot of us is Democrats, and we talking about real stuff, hating America, diversity. Now we getting busy in these little lunches. You don't even know about, that's real talk. And so one day we talk, this guy, I can't tell you his net worth, I can't tell you, he's big though. Like this guy, when I did the knowledge, he's one of the biggest guys in the world. He published 50 books on his own. He's a scholar, guys. Like, I mean, like, he's one of the ones, right? He's still alive. He's like 92 years old. Where he lives, right? So people, you could be rich and live on the water and have a $50 million house. Where he lives is a place called Golden. This is the only way I could figure his worth. I'm not going to Google his net worth, right? So he lives, his house. It's the backyard, is the beach in Golden Beach. This guy's like $100 million, $200 million house, right? Sweetest guy. And the man gets up with me after we talk. He says, man, Joe, I wish I had a generous heart like you. I don't give nobody nothing. I said.
Not in the spirit of Herbert H. Lee.
No, I'm trying to tell you,
that I've literally bumped into people who think I'm crazy for giving back. That they tell me, are you kidding me? You giving back? What are you doing? Like, you know, this guy got so much money. I don't got nothing like this guy. And he's like, you too generous, man. I would never give back. I'm like, wow, this guy 92, he ain't giving back. He got all that money. He's like, but it just lets you know, some people want to give and some people don't. But I also believe that it has to be led by somebody that's credible, that we know, yo, if I give him this money, it's going to the right place. That's very important.
We pressed for time, but I do want to
say— Are we? Though the conversation just started.
I don't know.
Let me tell you something, man. It's the biggest conversation in Lehman College. Man.
Well, don't do that. We're going to take some executive privileges here for a second. But you've been in Washington, D.C. a lot lately.
Yes, sir.
You were at the State of the Union.
Yes, sir.
And subsequent to that, there was a really big meeting you were at in a house that everybody knows.
So tell
us first, why were you at the State of the Union? And then tell us about what was happening at the White House.
Well, something nobody really knows, only my close friends, is that politics is my main hobby. And so I eat, sleep, drink politics. I don't get involved. I never want to be a politician.
I got to run that campaign whenever
ever.
I'm going to run that campaign.
Never. Please, anybody who's thinking of being a mayor or something, don't worry about me. I'm not coming. I'm not coming. I like making money too much. I'm being honest with y'all. And so, but it's my thing. You know, so the presidential address, you know, Joe Biden's going to give it. It was like the Super Bowl of politics. I see everybody from both sides. I'm up in there. I'm like, wow. And I had the nosebleed. Worse than that up there. I was all the way in the top. Not too mad. The governor, Kathy Hochul, was sitting right next to me. We was up the deck, baby. They treated New York bad out there in the seat. We was all the way up there. They said, all right. You know, New Yorkers all the way up. But what's crazy is I had the time of my life. Mm-hmm. I sat next to people, we talked, we clapped, we this, we that. And it was amazing to me. You know, I think UK got the best politics. That's more like a Fat Joe politics. Like when they get up and they argue with each other, they debate, like I'm down for that. Like that's like, no sir, you are disgusting at what you do. Like I love those politics, man. Check that out on C-SPAN, boy. They get busy over there. And so,
but you were representing an issue.
I'm fighting for healthcare price transparency. Yes. Okay. So what happens is, I got a friend, Kevin Mora, founder of Power to the Patients, an organization. He's been my friend for over 20 something years. And he stepped to me and said, look, this is what's happening in America. This has happened to Americans. And of course he spun it to me like, it's worse in the black and brown community, Joe, and this and this and that, right? I think this is the only issue you could find on earth that's bipartisan. This is the only issue that affects black, brown, white, Asian, Native American, you name it, Amish. And there's over 100, there's 350 million Americans. There's over 100 Americans in debt because of healthcare issues. That means one out of every three Americans knows what I'm talking about. And so Washington would have you believe that we don't know what Fat Joe's talking about, right? And so you got a kid who goes in the hospital and goes for an EpiPen, they charge him $17,000. When he looks online, it costs $200. You got women going in there for a MRI in the same hospital. They saw charging somebody $800, charging somebody $24,000, charging somebody else $66,000 in the same. Imagine I try to sell you this water for $2,000, $64,000. You'd be like, yo, what's up? The math is funny. It don't add up. And so we know when the family don't got money, the family feuds. And it breaks up households in America. It's just, I could go down the line every way, shape, and form. And what's weird to me is I get the job done. Okay, so this kids, not kids, well, young adults, you got to get the job done. Right? So when I sit in, I don't care. The way I'm talking to you, I don't want this to come across arrogant. The way I talk to you is how I talk to the president. So I talk to billionaires. I stand up and I'm Fat Joe. Yo, look, this is what's up. Okay, you guys got voted in.
I've seen it.
I made mines on my own. So let me tell you how this thing is done. Right? And so, you know, I go the first time 3 years ago to Washington, D.C., and a journalist stops me and she goes, hey, Fat Joe, I'm going up the Capitol. She's like, what are you doing here? Like that. I said, what do you mean? She said, this is Washington. Nothing gets done here. What are you doing? This is the welcoming committee, right? So I say, oh, you gotta be kidding me. You know, I get the job done. Whatever I do, I get the job done. I leave, we have one. He was a Republican guy too. He's from Kansas. His name is Guthrie. He sat down with me. I understand. I know I was in health. My mother has Alzheimer's. This, I get it, Fat Joe. I get it, right? I go back the next year. 45 congressmen and senators meet with me. We get it, Joe. We know what you're talking about. We think it's time, this, that. I go back this year. 85 politicians. Joe, we get it. We know what's up. We see you. We know, we feel you. We out here. You're right. The people need change. The people need transparency, right? So at least for me, I'm seeing the motivation. I'm seeing the results. I'm seeing the conversation moved along. We got a law passed in Congress that had funny, you know, yo, man, these things. Yo, the language is very important, guys. Stick to school, learn language. Because Congress passed the law and we're grateful that they did something for the first. You know, now, I'm not criticizing them, but they passed the law on transparency, but it says estimates. Mm-hmm. Estimates are guys. It's not the real deal. Oh, I think it might cost something. It might, and they send you whatever the bill is. So we like the language that Senator Braun and Senator Sanders teamed up together, Republican and Democrat, and that language says, we want to see the prices. Yeah. Now, what does the prices mean? The prices means if I got to take a test, I'm going to go to my three favorite hospitals, if you could call it that, and I'm going to see which one's going to give me the test for the least amount of money and quality. So now it creates a competition to where you actually have an option. The hospitals is the only place you go where you don't get a price. On earth, if you go to get a haircut, yo, it's $29.99. Rewind is extra. We got to paint your beard to rewind is extra. Why fight the time when we can rewind the time? I have hair products and...
You were also at the White House. Who invited you to the White House the following week?
Listen, I'm trying to... So my point of telling you all that is that I've always been a diehard Democrat, but in order to get stuff done, I have to talk to the Republicans to get it done. So when I post pictures of me and the Speaker Johnson and all of them, you know, I get, you're a sellout. You're talking to the other side. You're this, bro, this is the only way this is going to get done. It's the only way. Everybody got to agree. This is why I tell you I can't be a politician. Because I'm going up there to get the thing done. Like, I'm not here to lollygag and have dinners. I'm going to get the thing done. So people looking at me like I'm crazy. I walk up in there to the address. I go straight to the speakers. You want to hear some Bronx? I walk up in the speaker's thing, and I wasn't invited. He has, like, his own little gala before the address. Mm-hmm. I go up in there, oh, Fat Joe, he tells his wife, we got street cred. Fat Joe came through to say, it's cool. I talk to him about healthcare transparency, talk to Republicans. Obviously, I'm looking at lobster, shrimp, steak. Everybody's scared to eat first. In true Democrat form, I start the eating. I start grabbing, I grab shrimp, lobster, fix my plate. I'm like, now 100 people come behind me and start eating. Then I go back to the Democrat, Hakeem Jeffries, who's my man, hang out with everybody. So I'm trying to actually get something done, right? And so I'm not into making a big noise. I'm not into, I like to get it done. When I do something, I get the job done. That's just what I'm about. Okay, I hope
White House. It's crazy. Fat
Kamala Harris is my girl.
At the White House.
Okay. Sit. And so she asked me, Fat Joe, can you please come moderate at the White House, at the Roosevelt Room? It's never been done before. And we're going to talk about pardoning people and giving people a second chance. And so I'm not going to lie. They tap me and they say, yo, what's going on in the streets, Joe? What the people need, what they this and this and that. And I tell them what the people need, right? And unfortunately, there's one thing probably Lehman College can't teach you. And I believe that America doesn't believe in second chances. And it's sad, because you just heard a guy full of optimism. But I seen people treated unfairly because their grandfather was a gangster and they got the same last name. As soon as they come, if they imagine somebody, John Gotti's grandchild came to your classroom and was like, I'm Eleanor Gotti. You immediately think you might get your legs chopped off or something. And so America is very hard for them to give you a second chance. So of course it's the vice president. Of course she's talking my language. She wants to give pardons out to people, give them a second chance. And I met like 3 or 4 people who they gave pardons to who now became pastors and owners of businesses. And we had one guy, he couldn't coach his kid's team because he had a criminal record. Now when they pardoned him, he could coach his kid's team. Stuff like that. It was just amazing to me, right? And so I'm going to also tell you, like I told you earlier, I grew up dirt poor. I had nothing. I was in the projects, right? So when I walk into the Roosevelt Room and I see millions of cameras, and I'm literally, I don't know if y'all understand this, sitting next to the Vice President of the United States. Like, I don't care who you is, what you think, this, that. That is a flex, right? Not care what you think. You're in the good side of it, the bad side, who cares, right? But when I'm walking in the room, I start hearing in my head, we shall overcome. I'm like, yo. I used to read about Benjamin Franklin and this and that. Now I'm in the room. And so.
Proud of you, man.
And of course, I pulled her in the side room and started talking about healthcare, price, transparency. I said, Madam Vice President, I'm here for you. I love you, but I'm really here for price transparency. So send me your guy who I got to talk to. Because I am moving in that direction. And so I'm always focused. Always focused on what I'm doing.
Joe, if you don't mind, let's take some Q&A. Can we take some Q&A?
Yeah, let's go.
We could do a couple of questions from the audience. Yes, sir. Well, Tara, I don't know.
I got you.
You guys. Especially, we want to hear from the students as well.
Raise the hand. By the way, you know, I did my first paid show ever in Lehman College, ever. And Flo Joe was rocking.
Please identify yourself.
Thank you. Oscar Rigamonti, I am the scholarship coordinator here at Lehman College. I'm actually born in Watson and Ward around you guys' way. So my question is, you touched upon it, Don, is mentorship. And a lot of students who are going through high school and middle school tend to pick wrong, let's just say, mentors or people that they look up to. What value do you put on someone, a young adult, reaching out to you or someone like you, asking for guidance?
I'm gonna be honest with you, I'm hard to catch. So that's why I go on my Instagram and be totally transparent. You will never find another rapper on the level of me who will be more vulnerable and open up his space to let you know the wins and the losses, whether it's a family member dealing with drug addiction, whether it's how we grew up or whatever we did or how I just failed at something. That's all trying to teach. Everything I'm leaving is documented. If I go tomorrow, my book, everything is documented, showing you that it's possible. Let me tell you guys something. Not only do I think, I know you guys can be CEOs, presidents, leaders of the country. You can be whatever you want to be. Right? And so my thing is, you know, think of that. Think if Jay-Z grew up in the projects, he's a billionaire. What happens when you're a billionaire? You employ 100,000 people. 50 Cent, the most troublemaker in the world. He's the number one TV guy in the world. He's the number one TV guy in the world. But if he would have listened to the doubters, if he would have listened to the naysayers, if he would have listened to everybody who told him he couldn't be nothing, he'd be right on Queens on the block. If Fat Joe listened to these guys who said, you can't make it, you're never going to do it, you're never going to this. Now, me personally, I'm going to give you a direct thing because it happened right here, right? I lived in the Bronx till I couldn't live in the Bronx. Put it like that. I was already rich, still living in the Bronx, till my wife woke up one day and there was a car that drove too slow past the house. And she said, we either moving or I'm leaving you. And I said, all right, we did this too long. We overstayed our welcome. You right, baby. Let's go. Right? But the point is, every day, a friend of mine used to own a sneaker store in Southern Boulevard. And I would ride a bicycle. This is when I first started my losing weight. I would ride a bicycle from Throsneck to Southern Boulevard every single day. Every single day, you could see Fat Joe riding his bike. I was a star already, right? One day, I ride the bike, and on every single corner, there's gang members. Every single corner, gang members. I don't want to really tell you who, but they had the colors on. Every single corner, three guys going like this. Every single corner, three girls going like this. Every single corner, they knew my route every day. They were like, I said, let me stop for a Diet Pepsi. Right? By the time I come out the store, it's 20, 30 gang members around. Joe, he was sent here by the God Almighty, the King of Kings. Word, the Lord of Lords. He wants to talk to you. I said, really? It was like, we could get him on the phone right now. Get on the phone with him. He says, yo, Joe, you know, I want to meet up with you. You know, all the kids, they love you and Big Pun. And at this time, we the biggest. Like, we selling millions of, we the hottest. I said, all right, let's meet. So we meet up in Jimmy's Cafe, right? And so you got the guy, all right? This guy. I'm telling you, this is the guy. He got three guys with him, and I guess they're the leaders or the generals or whatever. And so he says, listen, man, I got over 10,000 guys who follow me in this gang, and they all want you and Big Pun in this gang. The Bloods got Suge Knight. The Crips got Snoop Dogg. This one got this. And we want you to be with us. I said, of course, Fat Joe style. I sit down. By the way, so I sit down, I look at him, I say, you finished? He said, yeah. I said, well, do you have a principal of a school in your gang? This wasn't even bad. This was like, do you have a principal of a school in your gang? He says, no, we don't have a principal. Do you have a school teacher in your gang? No, we don't have a school teacher in our gang. Do you have someone who owns maybe a bodega in your gang of 10,000 people? Nah. So who should I want to be? That's simple. That's the Lord Almighty such and such. He's doing two life sentences. Human beings can't even touch him. He's isolated. You can't even talk to him. Really? Who's like the second? That's even more simple. The OG such and such. He's in jail for triple life. His mother could never see him again. My man, you want me to join some shit like that, man? You got me fucked up. Like, you don't see this money I'm getting over here? Like, are you crazy, man? And so I didn't want to say that story to people so much because I don't want to actually embarrass these people who later on when I did the research, these guys were burning people alive. These guys that I was talking to like that were actually psychopaths. I seen some shit on 2020, they was burning people alive. I said, damn, Joe, you crazy. You was really talking to this guy like that. But he got the message. He laughed. I laughed. Said, boom, he knew, yo, Fat Joe's crazy. And so,
let's take the opportunity to say right. Goodbye to all the students.
Yo, thank man, you thank you.
Thank you all, let's give it up. Young World, thank you. Thank you for being with us. We appreciate you.
You guys are leaders. You guys are kings and queens. I might have cursed too much on that last one, guys. It turned from PG-13 to gangster rap.
You're gonna take a couple of more questions.
Let this one.
Yes.
Oh, Joe, I run a workforce development program here in the Bronx. How can I get you to come to Woodlawn Cemetery and inspire my kids? Or have you got a friend that'll come? Let's face it, I'm an old white woman. They need somebody of color with enthusiasm to inspire them to work hard. What do I do?
We'll come
he,
by.
Before he answers that.
We'll come by.
Make the correlation between workforce and Woodlawn Cemetery for everybody.
Yeah. This shit getting scary.
Yeah.
All right, Joe. 10 years ago, we decided that somebody needed to clean all these monuments. Woodlawn's 400 acres, if you haven't been there.
Beautiful.
And somebody needs to prune the shrubs and plant the trees and keep it looking good. It's a National Historic Landmark. What are we going to do? Contractors are too expensive. So we started partnering with the schools in the Bronx to get students 18 to 24 years old that aren't going to college, that don't know what to do, to get high-paying careers. We've already got kids that are in Local 1 making $31 an hour.
Yeah.
So that they can stay in the Bronx, that they can pay their rent, that they can buy that car. But I know that if I had someone with the spirit and enthusiasm of you, who has a little name recognition?
Hey, listen, I don't have no problem popping up. Rubén has set it up. Speak to his people, we'll pop up.
All right, everybody. Clap. Thank you.
Let's get some more questions very quickly. Thank you. Very quickly, we have someone up here, up there, and then we'll get to you. Come. Oh.
Here you go.
We're gonna go with the students and then
don't
we'll get to you.
Don't worry, let them answer the questions, man. Let's just move.
Hi, Joe. Hi, Rubén. My name's Anna. I'm a senior at Lehman. I'm majoring in business. I graduate this year, too. I enjoyed hearing the talk today, and you know the giveaways, it was meaningful to hear. So my question to you is, out of all the giveaways, all the give backs you've done, which one was the most meaningful and why?
You ain't got a clue. Right? Fat Joe has probably paid for 100 funerals in the Bronx. Yeah? Fat ants, huh? So I done paid for 100 funerals in the Bronx. And so whenever you hear somebody dying, they come to me. And they say, yo, Joe, senora such and such, or miss such and such. Just last week I did one for somebody who died in my block. And so, you know, Ortiz Funeral Homes know Fat Joe well, and they take the bag. And so, you know what's sad? I'm gonna tell you something. I looked up to my uncle. He passed away, and my uncle is a man, right? In a different way. I know we in school, but my uncle used to own number spots, right? So number spots are illegal gambling. But at one time, that's all we had in the hood. We didn't have no casinos. My uncle owned like 300 of them, right? I used to see him get out his Cadillac and people run up and kiss his hand and, you know. And then one day, New York City want to make tax money, so they made numbers lottery. So everybody who plays lottery, you really playing numbers. Idea that came from the hood. And they shut down all his number spots. They took all his money, millions of dollars, took all his money. I was just a kid. But I never heard the man complain one time saying, yo, I'm broke. I used to have money at this. So I modeled my life after him, right? And so even though my uncle was humble, he never took money from me. He always worked hard, whatever. When he died, right, I wanted to make a movie. So I wanted Fat Joe to be at the casket. Most beautiful funeral you ever seen in the Bronx. And when they come, they know, yo, my uncle's nephew was there. And so what was crazy is I went to pay for it, and then I caught COVID for the first time right there. And so I wasn't able to be there, but it meant a lot. Yeah.
Thank you. Real talk. I was there with my dad. It was beautiful. We have somebody on the top. I don't know if we can hear the mic.
Yeah, we can't hear the mic.
Oh, it's all right. I guess I'll just yell. Hopefully you can hear me.
Donna, it works now.
All right, perfect. So my name is Estefania, and first and foremost, I want to thank both of you for pulling up today, for representing the Bronx, and for all the work you do for the community. I work for a program that seeks to connect Bronx middle and high school students to careers in STEM. My question to you is this. So obviously there's a need out there in the economy. You know, there's talent here, but sometimes the talent that we have don't recognize that in themselves, right? So how can we bridge the gap? How can we get our students to see themselves as really part of the future? Because sometimes when we talk to them, they're so disassociated, all they know is the hood. It's hard for them to see other options.
Mm-hmm. Well, let me give that a try. You said STEM, we call it STEAM now, right? I think they added arts to it. So it's science, technology, engineering, arts, and math now. My day job is I'm a senior vice president now at Montefiore. And we're working with the Department of Education where we're bringing in a STEAM center to the east part of the Bronx. I'll give you some of that information where we're gonna have feeder schools come in. And there's one happening in every borough. The one that we're doing in the Bronx, partner up with Montefiore, we wanna do it around life science, we wanna do it around biotech, and around healthcare. And the way that we wanna do that is to inspire the students so that they come to the STEAM Center, but also have the professionals that work at Albert Einstein College of Medicine, the scientists, have the kids go to the labs. The thing is, having young people are way more precocious than we ever were. They want more, they know what they want. And again, they're talented, but we don't put them in the settings. And quite frankly, they're bored of the way they're being educated. Mm. And so we need to put them in the situation that they dream themselves in being, just so they can get a little taste. In the same way that we just touched a little bit upon that when it comes to sneakers and a sneaker giveaway, that inspired them, we need to look at kids, meet them halfway in their passion. So if they want to be a police officer, then maybe they need to be around that environment just so they can taste it. If they want to be a scientist, they should be in the lab. And this way there's a light at the end of the tunnel. And then once that happens, then they just have tunnel vision without none of the other distractions. They want to get to that light. Obviously, having someone like Joe and others, and I wish we had 20 more like him, but we just don't. But just having these types of conversations, I think, inspires people.
See, so my dream, and Ruben knows that, and my ultimate dream is to make a school in the middle of the South Bronx that looks like 90210 made out of glass, with indoor pool, with the stuff you see on CNN where they change the screens like this, free of charge. And I want diabetes 101. I don't want them to learn the stuff they learn now. I want them to know diabetes 101. If you eat bread, it turns into sugar. If you eat rice, it turns into sugar. If you don't follow the rules, you're gonna go blind or get your leg cut. Boom. That's one of the biggest things in the Bronx, right? I want to teach financial literacy 101. How to take care of your financial literacy 101. I want to teach drug abuse 101, because I believe that kids want to know what they want to know, and we got to teach them what's really going to benefit their future. And so, with no disrespect, I've had a big rift between me and schools, even though I tell all the kids to go to college and do whatever. But I don't know if Paul Revere is going to pay my bills today, right? And so I want kids to learn that stuff that they can actually implement in life to further their health, further their growth, further their financial freedom. And so that's my end goal. That's a dream of mine. And you'll see what will happen in that school, man. These kids will come out with flying colors. They'll be leaders in the future. They'll be, because we teaching them what they got to know in the world. And so my thing is, the fact is, to give you a real answer, right, is true winners have a certain DNA. So I don't care if it's Beyonce singing at a brush in front of her window. I don't care if it's the kid who, there's a kid, like when I don't know if y'all see them, but when I go to Washington, D.C., I definitely meet future Rubén Díazes. Like there's 18-year-old kids with the suit. They look like Obama. Hi, Mr. Cartagena. They know what it is. It's on. Like they were born for that, right? I got a cousin, Little Mark. Little Mark wants to be a cop. He's probably going to be the first cop in my whole entire family. But he gets around my security, who were former cops. He says, man, the FR-14, the pressure, the this, you know, the bulletproof. It is what it is, right? And so I just think everybody who are winners have winning DNA. They just got to figure out what is it that's going to make them win? What is the path? What are they going to do? I also believe in entrepreneurship. I don't believe in working for nobody, right? Because look what happened to me the other day. So for the first time in the history of sneakers, sneakers are going slow. The hood, they always want sneakers. For some reason, they got income tax this year. They said, hold up. I got real bills out here. I can't buy no sneakers, right? So if I'm doing okay, John and Tommy, who own they're in trouble. Like if Fat Joe's flying over the radar and it's the store that every kid wants to buy their sneaker, whoever's the mom and pop, they in trouble. So I call my rep. I won't tell you where, but she's a big time and a big sneaker thing. She pretty much made me. She's the one who gave me permission to carry sneakers and open my stores. You need permission for that too, guys. Right. So I call her and I'm like, yo, what's going on out there? She's like, so we get to talk. And she said, Joe, I want to tell you something. Don't be surprised if you heard they fired me soon. This is the woman who put me in the game. She's, you know, it's cuts and, you know, I get paid a little bit too much. I think I'm going to be on the chopping block. I was like, whoa. So I don't believe in jobs. I don't believe in job security. I believe in you being an entrepreneur, owning your own business. I actually see more power in the woman selling oranges on the freeway than I do on somebody who thinks they have a good job. And so it's all about ownership, because the one or two, three things I do that is actually considered a job, but I'm the president of everything. Like, no, I'm the president. Like, I'm the Fat Joe's the president of this division, I have like two, three jobs. I don't like how they talk to me. I don't. When they get to talking, because then they turn into, you know, we pay you. Right, Joe? Like, so I know you don't want to do it, but we need you to. And I'm like, man, I came too far for these people to be talking to me like this. So I ain't even like how it feels for somebody to come tell me what to do. I got jobs, but I'm being honest with you. Being an entrepreneur It's the only way.
Thank you. My forgiveness. We're pressed for time. I just want to say this, that again, Fat Joe is different than the Lindsay Wagner, the Lindsays and the Wagners, and the Pat Moynihans and all of the Pulitzer Prize winners that have graced and blessed this lecture series.
Listen, we are the Wagners and the Lindsay Graces and the John Escott. We the ones. Don't let them tell you nothing else. We the ones. We came from nothing and made it to something. We give people hope and inspiration. We the ones. Don't let nobody tell you. We are the Lindsay Wagners. And I told the young lady, what's her name over here? She's happy now. What's the one I hugged? Tara, you look like you needed a hug bad out there. You were stressed out. I say, Tara, I stand back there and they got these names going down there. I said, yo, Tara, come here. Is my name going to be up there? She said, your name passed, Joe. I said, so I'm going to be up there with the Herman Lehman and all these guys, right? Fat Joe. She said, yes, your name's going to be on there. And you know, that's what it's about. And so, I'm going to tell y'all something. I got to say something real clear because, No, I need you all to go home with this message, right? I did not come here to brag about how I gave back to people or how I give to people, right? That's what the thing was about. What I am about is inspiring and being transparent and letting some kid or somebody who just needs to hear something that'll change their life. That's what this is about. Total transparency so that you can say, yo, man, the man was from the project, the man this, that, he made it happen, I can make it happen. That's what this is all about. This ain't about Fat Joe bragging about giving to charity, because I do it from the heart.
Your name is up there now.
God damn, it's a new day. See, that's it.
Let me just say this. We appreciate it.
And I'm going to speak something into existence. I don't want to block when I die. I'll tell you, I got a lot. As long as I'm living and healthy, I'm going to do some things so remarkable for the communities that you have never seen in the history of mankind. Remember, I told you, when I'm done, we're going to give back at a level that you've never seen before. But I told Rubén, I don't want Fat Joe Boulevard. I want the bridge, the Harlem River Bridge. I want the bridge. I'm going to speak it into existence. I want the bridge. I want the...
Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. President, board members of Lehman College, I just want you to know this. I'm blessed that this school gave me an education that was affordable. This school allowed for a young husband, a young politician to be able to get an education. But more so than anything that I learned in books, more so than I learned in anything from any professor, taking nothing away from them, I was able to learn more than anything else from the people that I sat next to. I was a non-traditional student. And to everything that I know about cultural diversity and sensitivities and religion, I learned because there's such a diverse student body at this school. Don't ever let no one trivialize where you come from or where you got educated. When I first got up to Albany, I sat
from the Bronx. We started everything. Don't let nobody lie to you. We started everything. Tupac from the Bronx.
Yeah. When I first got to Albany, I sat next to an assembly member who asked me, where are you getting your education from? I was still a student. I said, Lehman College. He said he was Harvard, Yale. And nothing taken away, nothing from Ivy League school, but I just don't like the way he said it to me. He was almost trying to, you know, diminish where I was getting it. So I said, wait a minute, hold on. You Harvard and Yale Law, and I'm Lehman College, and here we are sitting next to each other. Either, I told him, it's true talk, Joe. I said,
I do it worse. They say, where you from? I say, Forest Projects, what's up? I'm here, right? It is what it is.
I told them, either I'm a huge success or you a terrible failure. Ladies and gentlemen, Fat Joe, thank you all for being out of here. We out.
Thank you. My brother.
Thank you.
on the watch, watch them make now. Like this up chandelier, and the pussy like voodoo, Santa Rhea. Bet your man ain't getting money like me.
Nope.
Bet your lil chop on me. Whole life on parole, can't talk to felons. Now tell that bitch up in the cops, a man still telling. Still telling, still telling. Throw that whole chick away, that still telling. Still telling, still telling. Look at these niggas ducking time, they're still telling. What's up, face down? Yes. What's up, face down? Face there.
La Caldi. Body. Never been stressed by. No. Never been pressed by. Murder and the money on my mind. My palm and my trigger finger itch. I've been in my bag. Hopping out of jets. Been running shit. Stealing out of breath. I can lay a verse. And ladies to rest. Catch it. Traffic, hope you say it with your chest. Hit it on deck. It ain't nothing but a check. Lace run pushes. Why the f you got a vest? Looking. Me, hit my line, 1-800-5-9-BX.